Hi, everyone. Aaron here for Zolotech, and today Apple released iOS 14.2 Release Candidate, or GM. A release candidate is the exact same thing as a GM. They're just using a different name. GM means Golden Master, and Release Candidate basically means it's a version ready to go out to the public if no one finds any more bugs. This is available currently to developers and public beta testers, and so once you install this version, it's similar to that of a GM. Basically, just remove the beta profile, and when the final version is out, you'll already have it. If they patch the final version and release a different update, well, then you'll have the update. Either way, this should be the final version, and we'll talk about when to expect it for the public a little bit later. Now, this particular update came in at 4.34 gigabytes on my iPhone 12 Pro and was similarly sized on the 2020 iPad Air 4th generation, iPhone 11, and iPhone 11 Pro Max. And so this particular update initially fixes a lot of bugs, adds a few extra things, and the first thing it fixes, which I know a lot of people will be happy about, is that annoying message that kept popping up that said a new iOS update is now available. Please update from iOS 14 beta. So if you were getting that message, that will now stop. And that's why I suspect Apple released this update on a Friday, which is really unusual. Now let's take a look at the build number. We'll go to settings, then we go to general, and then about, and you can see the build number is 18B91. And this particular build may be the final, like I said. Now they also released iPadOS 14.2 release candidate. And so we'll go over everything that's new. And the first thing is there is no new modem update unless you're coming from 14.1 once this is finally released. So if you were on beta 4, there is no new modem update. And also, there's a couple new things within this update. Quite a few things, actually. The first thing is, if we go into the control center, you may already remember this from earlier betas, but if you press and hold on the not playing or now playing button, you'll get suggestions as to what to play next in the control center. However, if you're already playing a song, so let me drop the volume here. If you're already playing a song and then you go back to the control center, you can see your song playing, press and hold, and now the song will actually show it that it's playing. So it's a little bit different. They changed it up a little bit as far as the control center, and they added additional controls for home as well. So if you go to the home app, there's a couple changes here. One is that we have a discover button now, or discover tab. They've also changed the home icon. So those are slight changes that they've made. And then also there's more controls for home. So if you have a HomePod connected, you'll have some of those controls. So if you press and hold on home, you can go into your favorites, of course, and things are just changed a little bit within the home app. They've also fixed if you had a missing line here in the control center. Now also in the control center, when you AirPlay a song or AirPlay to a different device, it looks a little bit different. And so they've redone the way it looks. If you have a HomePod in here, it will look different as well. Now, iOS 14.2 brings over 100 new emoji, and you can see them here. So there's a bunch of them here, from roller skates to a truck to a pepper. If we go down a little bit further, we have a hook and a boomerang and a bunch of other ones. They're fun to discover. You'll find that there's a bunch of new ones to be updated to bring them up to Unicode standards. So now we have over 100 new emoji with food, faces, household objects, musical instruments, gender inclusive emojis, and more. Now there's also new wallpaper. In fact, there's 8 new wallpaper. And if we go into settings, we'll go over to our wallpaper, go into choose a new wallpaper, and then we go to stills, and we have 8 new ones. So you can see them here. I went over these in previous beta updates, but you'll see here's one new one. Here's another one. And these are very similar to what's coming with macOS Big Sur. So as I cycle through them, there's some more with rocks. I think this is Big Sur, but there's a bunch of rocks. And then we have a drawing of the Pacific Coast Highway, and they all change depending on day and night. Here's another one. You'll see it's sort of a lake in between a valley, drawn again, a desert drawn, and then another one here where it's sort of a shoreline drawn as well. And again, like I said, once you flip to dark mode, they change. I won't go through every single one of them, but you'll see in the rocks formation, you have the starry night as far as the background. So it's sort of blacked out. You can't really see it, but on the camera, you can't see it, but there are stars there. If we go to the Pacific Coast Highway, it's sort of a bluish purple color for the drawing. I don't know that I like that for the actual wallpapers, but those are a bunch of new ones. And of course, that's really it. So nothing more as far as those, but they are some nice new wallpaper. Now there's an update to the Magnifier app. If you're using that, first you need to enable it. You go to Settings, then you go down to Accessibility, then you go to Magnifier. Make sure it's turned on. And if it's turned on, open the Magnifier app and go to Settings and you'll have a new option, and it has people detection. Now, Apple says this is specifically for the iPhone 12 Pro and 12 Pro Max series phones with the LiDAR sensor, that it will now detect people and then measure a distance to them. Prior to this update, it was working on the iPhone 11 Pro Max. So let's go into the same thing. We'll go into Magnifier. And you'll see that the people option is missing now on the older phones. So it really needs that LiDAR sensor to measure distance, using it to bounce off of objects and tell you the correct distance to them. So that's in the Magnifier app. Now, if you have AirPods, there's a nice new feature. So let me go ahead and put in my AirPods Pro. We'll connect them to a phone here. Wait for them to connect. Hopefully it connects to my 12 Pro. So you'll see my AirPods Pro are now connected. And if I go into the settings for AirPods under Bluetooth, go to AirPods Pro, scroll down, we now have optimized battery charging. Just like we get with the iPhones, we now get it with the AirPods, so that it will sort of not charge past 80% until it learns when we use them. So maybe you charge them overnight, it charges to 80%. If you grab them in the morning, it will make sure it's at 100% before you leave, but it will wait to charge it from 80 to 100. Exactly the same way it works for iPhone. Now, iOS 14.2 also adds support for the new iPhone 12 leather sleeve with MagSafe. So if you saw that with the Apple event, we'll go over here. You'll see here's a red one. This is what the leather sleeve looks like. It will have the time showing through, and it uses MagSafe to know that it's on. This update adds support. Maybe that's why we haven't seen them available yet in the store. So that seems to make sense. Now, also within settings, Apple has updated the iPhone with sound and haptic settings for headphone safety. So you can now have notifications if something is too loud. It will help you reduce those sounds. So you have a couple new options: headphone notifications, you can see over the last 6 months, and also reduce loud sound. So some of these updates have changed, and so they've added audio level notifications to alert you when audio levels could impact your hearing. It's a nice little update. Now, also, they've updated the iPhone to support intercoms. So if you have a HomePod or a HomePod Mini and you're using an iPhone or an iPad, an Apple Watch, AirPods, or CarPlay, you can actually use the intercom with it. It allows you to connect your phone through that intercom in home. So if you're at home and you have a HomePod, you can use it as an intercom. So I don't have it currently available here because it's not in the same area as me, but you will be able to use it as an intercom. Also, the update allows you to connect HomePod to Apple TV 4K for stereo, surround sound, and Dolby Atmos support. So if you have a HomePod nearby and you want to connect it to your Apple TV and you have the same update on your HomePod, you'll be able to do that. Now, there's a new option in exposure notifications. So if you go into settings, and then you go down to exposure notifications, and you have an app installed that uses it. It will not be available if you don't have an app installed. If you do have an app installed, you'll now have a new option for share a diagnosis within the app. So what this allows you to do is provide statistics about exposure notifications without identifying you to participating public health authorities. So you have that option. You obviously have your monthly updates and availability alerts, but if you don't want this on, simply turn it off. And then it's off. You can turn it off and delete data, and now it's gone. So it's up to you whether or not you want this on. It's completely your choice. Now, with iPadOS 14.2, there's some new updates to newer iPads. So for example, with this fourth generation iPad Air, there's now scene detection in the camera. So if we go into the camera, it uses intelligent image recognition to identify objects within a scene and automatically improves the photo on this particular iPad. It's specific to the fourth generation 2020 iPad Air. So it should recognize this is an iPhone, snap a picture. We'll take a look at the picture. It looks pretty clear, and it should help improve photos overall. Now, if you're using a 12.9 inch fourth generation iPad Pro or an 11 inch iPad Pro second generation with the LiDAR sensor on the back where the camera is, it has a couple new options. So you'd need to first turn on Magnifier. You do that by going to Settings, and then you go to Accessibility, and then Magnifier. As long as you have that on, you'll now have the option for Magnifier. So if we go into the magnifier, if you have an iPad with a LiDAR sensor, what it can do is detect people nearby and report their distance. The same as we get with the iPhone 12 Pro. And so it's a nice little feature, but it's only available for those with LiDAR sensors. So that's something that new. And then also, again, on this fourth generation iPad Air, there's a new feature, and it's auto frames per second in the camera. So if you're in the camera, maybe you're taking a video, for example, you'll see it's at 4K 60 here in the top. If you're taking a video here, it will reduce the frame rate when recording video to improve low light. That's an option usually. It's been on iPhones for a little while, but basically if you're taking video and it's in really low light, it actually will reduce the frame rate. So if I turn this off, well, it didn't reduce it automatically, but usually it will reduce the frame rate and help with video quality overall. Now, within this update, there are a ton of fixes as well, and there's quite a few that they've told us about. There may be more that they haven't. And so the first one is apps could be out of order on the home screen dock. So sometimes these could rearrange themselves in the dock. They've fixed that. And then also, I've heard this quite a bit from people, is when they open the camera, it would just appear black. They've fixed this on all phones. Now, they did say they fixed this, I believe, with 14.1, but it didn't fix it for everybody. That was only for the iPhone 7. Now it seems like they've fixed it for everyone. Now, also, if you're on the lock screen, they've fixed an issue where the keyboard may miss touches if you're typing something in, whether that be an emergency phone number or something else. It should now work properly. Now, also, if you had issues with reminders going back to different dates, that has now been fixed. So they said could default to times in the past, so that should be resolved. And also, if you're having issues with the photos widget not displaying anything, they've fixed that. In fact, they fixed quite a few things with widgets. For example, the weather widget could display high temperatures in Celsius when set to Fahrenheit. They've fixed issues that people were having with widgets, hopefully all of them at this point. Also, they've fixed an issue if you're using voice memos, for example, where it would be interrupted if you got a phone call. That should be fixed so you can dismiss the phone call and it will keep recording with voice memos. Also, specifically, if you're using Netflix, the screen could go black. They've now resolved that. If you're using Apple Cash, it could fail to send or receive money when using Siri, so they've fixed that issue. That was long known, at least in many of the early betas. Now, if you're using the watch and you have the watch app open, they fixed an issue where it could just crash unexpectedly. So that should now be resolved. Now, the next issue I know quite a few people were having, including my wife, where GPS routes tracked by your watch were not syncing back to your phone. So they fixed that issue. So GPS routes or health data are now syncing properly with the phone. Also, they've fixed an issue if you're using Apple CarPlay where it may incorrectly be labeled as not playing. So if you were seeing that, it should be fixed. They've also fixed an issue where phones would not wirelessly charge. I've heard of this from people randomly, so that should be fixed. They've also fixed an issue where if you're moving from one phone to another and you had exposure notifications enabled, it will now keep it enabled on the new phone and transfer all of your settings. Before, it wasn't doing that properly and it would just turn it off. And so all of those things have been fixed. There should also be some security updates within this update, but they haven't said specifically what they've fixed. And so that is everything in this particular update. A lot of new features, a lot of fixes, and a lot of those new features are for the new devices, but there are a lot of fixes as well. Now, as far as performance with iOS 14.2, well, I used it extensively on the iPhone 11 Pro Max, and performance-wise, I didn't really have many issues. I know people were having issues with iOS 14.1 from time to time, but this one should be much better, so I hope this gets much better. And also, battery life seems to be okay with this one. I know a lot of people were saying battery life was improved. And if we look at my battery health on the 11 Pro Max, I'm down to 93% after a year and a couple months at this point, or 1.5 months at this point. And over the last 10 days, while I did switch to the iPhone 12 Pro, you'll see the last day I had here, I only used 50% of my battery and got 4 hours and 41 minutes of screen on time, 59 minutes of screen off time. Meaning if I used 100% of my battery, I'd get close to the 10 to 12 hours that this phone should normally get. And so hopefully it's finally resolved the issues. I've heard a lot of good things from people using it. And of course I'll do a follow-up if you'd like me to, but let me know in the comments below. Now let's take a look at the benchmarks and then we'll talk about when to expect the final release. Now I ran Geekbench on all of these devices, and with the iPhone 12 Pro, of course, these scores are going to be a little bit off because I haven't run them before, so I'm not sure what the baseline is, but you can see right after installing the update, I scored 1,591 for single core, 3,853 for multi-core. On the other devices, let's take a look at the 11 Pro Max, since I have a backlog of history on that. I scored 1,333 for single core, 3,202 for multi-core. And so in general, it looks pretty good. You'll see here's October 20th versus October 30th, and it's doing pretty good. Better single core scores, lower multi-core, but I ran it while the phone was still fairly warm right after installing the update. And then finally with the iPad Air 2, I ran it on this and I scored 1,578 for single core, 4,240 for multi-core. So these are newer devices. I expect them to be fast, but these numbers will generally increase after a little while. So expect them to get better as the devices finish doing all the background processes and things like that. Now, as far as when to expect iOS 14.2, as far as the public release, well, based on what they did last time when they released iOS 14.1, I would expect this maybe Wednesday. Since we vote on Tuesday, it's possible they could push it out as early as Monday if there's no issues with it, but I would expect it maybe around Wednesday, if not the following Tuesday at the latest. But I really think it will be out to the public as early as this coming week. I don't see a reason not to, but again, we'll have to wait and see. And so other than that, I think it's a solid update. It's performing well. The beta's performed really well, and I think we're at a really stable point, and you should definitely install it if you're wondering if you should install the beta update. Absolutely at this point. If you don't have betas on your phone, wait till the final release comes out, and I think you'll be really happy with this release. In general, it should be really good and much more stable than we had iOS 13 at this point with iOS 13.2. 14.2 is much more stable. But let me know about your experience in the comments below, and if you found any other new features. Of course, I'll link this wallpaper in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.